Inside this jerrycan are a few grains of sorghum, the only food to last Ugash Adan Abdullahi's family another 10 days in Kenya's overwhelmed Dadaab refugee camp. Every day, hundreds of desperate people arrive at Dadaab seeking food and shelter, most from across the border in Somalia, where violent instability and a record bad drought has made life impossible for many. Abdullahi, his two wives and nine children walked some 500 kilometers from their village in southern Somalia to Dadaab, one of Africa's largest refugee camps, just over the border on Kenya's far eastern frontier. One of his wives, Shamsa Mahmoud, was pregnant during the tedious two-week journey. She gave birth on arrival, her newborn yet another addition to the 350,000 people who call Dadaab home. When we are given our food ration, we sell some of it to buy sugar and other necessary things, so we don't have enough food to last us until the next distribution. Inside there are few possessions. The mattress is gone, long sold for food. Between 400 and 500 people arrive at Dadaab every day, according to the UN Refugee Agency, UNHCR, mostly driven from Somalia after five consecutive seasons of failed rains. The World Health Organization says this drought, already the worst in 40 years, could result in the deaths of 135 people in Somalia every day between January and June this year.
Okay, it's challenging for the whole context of Dadaab that we are facing now, the new arrivals coming in. Because as you can see here, we are having this small outpost and it's supposed to cater for the population that is here. We're also providing water, which is never enough. We are constructing latrines. We have so far done 101 latrines. We are doing 50 more. It's never enough.
Some in Dadaab have also fled Al-Shabaab, the Al-Qaeda affiliate that controls swathes of rural Somalia and has fought a bloody insurgency to overthrow the government for more than 15 years. The camp opened in 1991 following the collapse of dictator Siad Barre's military regime and Somalia's slide into anarchy. For a long time, Dadaab, which Kenyan authorities have repeatedly threatened to close over the years, was the largest refugee camp in the world. It has since lost that title, but Dadaab remains imposing, boasting a population that rivals all but Kenya's biggest cities. All three of the settlements making up the vast tent city, Dagahale, Ifo, and Hagadera, are well beyond capacity.
The fingerprint that we normally do it to, it's a kind of a deterrent measure, whereby we make sure that the people we are profiling into our system are not registered. Because sometimes you will find that because the quantity of the food they're receiving is small, so they will like come back again so that they can get access to food for the second or third time. So what we make sure is that we verify again.
Abdullah and his family, like all new arrivals, end up on the very outskirts of the camp in extremely precarious conditions. Resources are overstretched by the sheer number of arrivals, and newcomers must make do.
As we have 130,000 new arrivals. The conditions are very dire, so those new arrivals, they either settle with friends and family in the camps or in the outskirts of the camps, spontaneously settled in the outskirts. So the 130,000, I mean, you know, we've received some funding, but not by any means, by any measure, sufficient to cover all the basic needs.
In this arid and inhospitable climate, water distribution is overseen by Doctors Without Borders, a French charity which also runs a health center for recently arrived refugees. Refugees are screened upon arrival by Kenyan authorities for any associations with Al-Shabaab, which controls territory just over the porous frontier, 80 kilometers away. They are then registered with the UNHCR to receive food rations and other support. Dadaab has not seen funding rise. A fourth settlement, dubbed Ifo2, is scheduled to reopen in the coming months to accommodate 80,000 refugees. It requires around $23 million to open and operate for the first year, but the United Nations has so far raised only $5 million.